In 1991, this tranquil pond in rural Connecticut was the scene of a horrific crime. Two young boys were beaten, thrown into the water, and left for dead. Investigators had little evidence until they examined the pond itself and found thousands of clues invisible to the naked eye in a simple drop of water. Waterford, a small Connecticut town where the water table is so high, homes are built around numerous small ponds and lakes. In 1991, two boys, we'll call Stephen and Bobby, decided to spend their afternoon fishing at their favorite spot, Stenger's Pond.
Oh, that was pretty good.
I told you.
Sometime later, they were approached by three older boys they didn't know. Without warning, one pulled a knife. The other two threw Stephen and Bobby to the ground. Stephen tried to fight back, but was hit on the head with a baseball bat, almost knocking him unconscious. Both boys had their hands and feet bound with duct tape and their mouths covered. Once out in the pond, Stephen was hit once again and held underwater so that he would drown. Bobby was next. Fortunately, he saw the bat coming and ducked, then pretended to be unconscious. After throwing Stephen and Bobby's fishing rods in the water, they took the boys' bicycles and fled. Bobby was able to remove the duct tape from his hands, mouth, and feet. He swam to Stephen to try and save him. By the time he got there, Stephen was unconscious. Bobby managed to get him to shore, then carried him a quarter mile to the nearest home.
Help! Help! Help!
Deborah Chamberlain heard a frantic knocking at her door.
Oh my God, what happened?
One had a serious head wound and was not very coherent, and the other was just almost hysterical. And so I knew that something awful had happened to the two boys, and that would be something that we would sort out over the next couple of minutes. But I think the duct tape was really almost my first impression, because I thought, oh my God, someone taped their wrists together.
Stephen was rushed to the emergency room of Lawrence and Memorial Hospital. Dr. John Urbanetti was Stephen's doctor.
Despite the number of people that I've seen with this kind of circumstance, he came as close as I've ever seen anyone come to not surviving.
As Stephen lay in intensive care, doctors questioned whether he would live or die. And Waterford police had questions of their own. Who had tried to murder Stephen and Bobby? And why? Waterford police detective Donald McCarthy was assigned to investigate the assault and attempted murder of the two young boys at Stenger's Pond. 13-year-old Stephen was fighting for his life, the victim not only of an attempted drowning, but of massive head wounds.
One of the doctors had told one of my detectives at the time that it was the closest he had ever seen anybody come to drowning and not being dead.
He was very lucky. The older child was unconscious. Had he not had his little friend with him, he probably would have drowned, I think.
Stephen's friend Bobby had escaped serious injury.
I think the remarkable thing is he had the presence of mind to immediately go to his friend and pull his friend from the water.
There's no doubt in our minds, if he did not remove that duct tape, the older male would have died if he did not remove him from that body of water.
When he came to the door, the little guy, amazingly, was quite a bit smaller than his friend, was just literally supporting him completely.
Police went to Stenger's pond to collect evidence, but they ran into a major obstacle. The crime scene was a body of water.
The fishing poles, the tackle box, the suspects had tried to sanitize the crime scene by throwing those items in the water so that the police would not recover them, making it difficult that the fact that they were submerged in water, we would not normally not have fingerprints available to us.
The bat used as the weapon was found floating in a nearby sewer grate, but there were no fingerprints. And any other possible evidence, such as hairs and fibers, had apparently been washed into the water. Police talked to residents of the neighborhood closest to Stenger's pond to see if they had seen anything unusual. Susan Picardi came forward to say that earlier on the day of the attack, a young teenager she had never seen before came to her door asking for help.
Can I help you?
Yeah, I was walking down the street when I began to feel a little lightheaded and hungry. May I come in and get something to eat?
He said he wasn't feeling well. He was a diabetic and was in need of something, whether it was sugar or orange juice or a piece of chocolate or something. I immediately felt bad for him and invited him in.
Come in and have a seat, and I'll get you some fruit juice.
Thanks.
Mrs. Picardi gave the young man a glass of orange juice. A few minutes later, he said he was feeling better, thanked her, and left.
Because I can call a doctor.
No, I'm fine. Thanks.
Later, as Mrs. Picardi was about to take a shower, she saw something unusual in her bathroom mirror.
And I caught the image of what was going on in my backyard from upstairs. And I saw two other youngsters in the corner of my yard, teenagers, 16-ish, around there. A redheaded boy and another Afro-American young man.
And they were later joined by the young man who just left Mrs. Picardi's home.
She gave me orange juice, she treated me so nice.
The boys had a bright green baseball bat and what looked like rolls of duct tape.
I automatically panicked and knew whatever they had planned was not going to happen at my house. So I yelled out the window to them, I think you better leave. It's obvious that you're planning something or you're up to trouble and I'm calling the police. So if you know it's good for you, then you better get going.
Susan Picardi was able to provide a detailed description of the boy who'd come to her door.
Mr. Picardi told us two things that stood out. One, he was wearing eyeglasses and described those eyeglasses to us. The other was he had an unusual shaped scar, a U-shaped ray scar, on his forearm.
Since the perpetrators were apparently on foot, police checked the neighborhoods nearest to Stenger's pond.
We put officers in that neighborhood and started doing neighborhood canvasses in that based on the description of the three suspects. As a result, we were able to identify the suspect immediately.
This suspect, 17-year-old Brian Davis, had the upraised scar described by Susan Picardi. Neighborhood informants identified the two friends Davis spent the most time with. One was 17-year-old Christopher Green. The other was an African-American juvenile whom we'll call Jason. All three suspects fit the descriptions provided by Susan Picardi, but denied they were involved in the assault. In Christopher Green's house, police found a knife like the one Bobby had told them about. In Green's basement, they found a pair of wet muddy sneakers.
We inquired of the suspect, why are these things wet? He was trying to tell us that it was as a result of walking through mud puddles and things like that. As soon as he said that, we started working on a theory that, how do we attack this? He's coming up with a defense. This is how my clothes got wet. I was playing in mud puddles and things like this.
Was the mud on Green's sneakers from Stenger's pond? And if so, how could scientists prove it? For the answers, police turned to a new type of forensic science, one that had never before been used in a criminal case anywhere in the world. Thirteen-year-old Stephen, the oldest of the two boys who were assaulted and left for dead in Stenger's pond, was in intensive care for a week. His condition gradually improved. He was extremely fortunate. Doctors found no evidence of permanent injury.
Fortunately, he'd had an episode that was short enough so that he suffered no permanent injury to his brain. But during the time of recovery, he needed a fair amount of intensive care support.
Police had three suspects in custody: Brian Davis, Christopher Green, and the juvenile we'll call Jason. All denied any involvement in the attacks. Brian Davis and Jason had no prior brushes with the law, but Christopher Green had a long history of petty offenses and small-time violence. Police took the sneakers from Green's basement, but no one was sure if the mud on the soles could be used as evidence.
We had the shoes. How do we find out now, find someone who's going to tell us what to do with this?
You understand exactly what it is we're trying to do.
Waterford police spent weeks calling around the country, looking for someone who might be able to help. The FBI told them of a scientist at nearby Connecticut College.
Here we are, we're going all over the United States. Connecticut College is 3 minutes, 5 minutes from our police station.
The scientist was Dr. Peter Siver, a forensic limnologist, an expert on microscopic life in freshwater environments. Dr. Siver was asked to find out if the mud on Green's sneakers came from Stenger's pond. He took the mud from the sneakers and added a mixture of sulfuric acid and potassium dichromate, which removed the dirt, leaving behind only the life forms that may have existed in the water. It's a world invisible to the naked eye.
Inside that small drop of water exists literally hundreds of different organisms. They come in all different arrays, all different shapes, all different colors, and it's an entirely different world underneath that one drop of water.
And what Dr. Siver found were diatoms, microscopic single-cell organisms, a form of algae. Each diatom is housed in an incredibly complex structure made up of silica or glass.
I would say that diatoms are pieces of art. They're pieces of art because each diatom can make exactly the same pattern each time it makes a new cell. And these patterns are very ornate. They're highly artistic in their look.
While diatoms may be art, they can also be pieces of evidence. Any body of water has hundreds, if not thousands, of species of diatoms. The types of diatoms and how many exist of the various species is unique to that body of water.
In any given water body, you can essentially examine the microscopic organisms and, in effect, create a fingerprint for that water body.
On the sneakers, Dr. Siver found large numbers of one type of diatom known as eunotia. Shown here Eunotia are characterized by the crescent shapes of their glass shells. There were three species of Eunotia on the suspect's sneakers, and they were there in unusually high concentrations. And Dr. Seiver found one more clue. He found what's known as a scaled chrysophyte. Scaled chrysophytes are related to diatoms, but unlike diatoms, they can swim. There was only one species of chrysophyte in the mud, Malamonas caudata, shown here magnified 2,000 times. When Dr. Seiver analyzed the water samples from Stenger's pond, he found the same high concentrations of Eunotia and the same species of scaled chrysophyte. The fingerprint of the water at Stenger's pond was the same as the sample on the sneakers of Christopher Green. This was the break police had been counting on.
One thing that we found is there's always a scientist out there. As off the wall as it may sound, or what you're trying to accomplish, we have found there's always somebody out there that will listen to you.
Christopher Green, Brian Davis, and Jason were arrested and charged with assault and attempted murder. But the question now turned to motive. Why did they attack the two young boys? And was there another intended victim that day? Forensic scientists found a way to prove that one of the suspect's sneakers had been in the water at Stenger's pond, where the two young boys had been assaulted and left for dead.
I think the physical evidence in this case was just overwhelming. The diatoms and the pond evidence, or the aquatic evidence, whatever way you want to use it, was just devastating. And I think the defense attorneys realized that.
The forensic analysis showed that when Christopher Green went into the water to strike his victims, he got mud on his shoes, mud that contained the microscopic fingerprint of the water in Stenger's pond. The diatoms in that mud clearly tied him to the crime scene.
For me, I thought it was unique and unusual because it's something that you normally don't read about in textbooks.
Even though Stephen and Bobby's bicycles were stolen after the assault, police and prosecutors do not believe robbery was the motive.
These three kids, I am totally convinced, were on a mission that day. As a result of interviewing the three after their arrest, they went out that day to look to kill somebody. There's no doubt in my mind.
Can I help you? Yeah.
Police believe that Susan Picardi was originally the intended victim. Brian Davis did not have diabetes, as he claimed, but only used it as an excuse to gain entry to her home.
Have a seat, and I'll get you some juice.
Thanks.
When he rejoined his accomplices in Susan's backyard, they may have been planning how to get into the house.
The real alarm bells went off when I went upstairs and I saw two boys in the corner of my yard. And then I sort of all put it together, and then I started feeling like I was just set up.
Fortunately, Susan Picardi saw them in her bathroom mirror and called the police. She looks back to that day and often wonders how close she was to danger.
A great way to describe it as a sixth sense. The mirror was in the right place. The kids were in the right place. It was meant to be for me to see them and to, just by their body language, understand that something is not right here.
Police determined that Christopher Green, the only one of the defendants with a history of violence, had instigated the attacks.
Christopher Green was probably the ringleader for the other two. He was the one that brought the bat. He was the one that brought the duct tape. He was the one that did the striking on our victims. He's the one that basically directed the other two.
Brian Davis and Christopher Green were both tried as adults and were sentenced to a minimum of 18 years in prison. Their 16-year-old accomplice, Jason, was only 2 weeks shy of his 17th birthday when he committed the crime. As a result, he was tried and convicted as a juvenile and was sentenced to spend time in the facility for young offenders. He has since been released. The microscopic diatom evidence on Christopher Green's sneakers, so simple in purpose, so magnificent in design, and so potent as evidence. For Waterford police and for law enforcement around the world, the case set a precedent.
It's a landmark case. It was the first time that this evidence, or evidence of an aquatic environment, meaning the diatoms, were used to place a suspect at a crime scene.
We found that it had never been used before. What was nice about it is they were willing to take it on and try it. And that was the key for us.
Shortly after this case, law enforcement in Switzerland solved the murder of a young boy using diatom evidence. The boy had drowned, and the species of diatoms in the victim's lungs matched the species of diatoms found on the gas pedal of the suspect's automobile. Both cases were solved because a group of Connecticut detectives had a hunch that some mud on the bottom of a shoe might tie a suspect to a crime.
I would never say give up being the old-fashioned, hard-beating-the-road cop. But you've got to be aware of the sciences that are there to help you. If you don't, you're beating yourself.
A lot of the thoughts that Lieutenant McCarthy came up with, we always thought were unusual. But 9 out of 10 times, he was right. I have to say 99.8% of the time, he was right.
In 1988, the body of a young woman was discovered in an Ohio river under ice. Most of the evidence found at the crime scene, hairs, fibers, and fingerprints, had been washed away. But the victim's 6-year-old son unwittingly told investigators all they needed to know about the killer. And he did it without saying a word. The clue was in his genes. Troop of Boy Scouts headed to Possum Run Creek one Saturday morning in January of 1988. Their mission was to pick up aluminum cans for a recycling project. In the icy creek in rural Ohio, they spotted what appeared to be a mannequin.
They saw something just under the ice, submerged.
It was the body of a young woman. Local police took every possible precaution to preserve trace evidence by wrapping the victim's body in a sheet before taking it to the morgue. A check of missing persons reports identified the woman as 32-year-old Margie Coffey, the single mother of 2 young children. She had been reported missing 10 days earlier.
The police had found her vehicle down off of Park Avenue East by a bar, and she was a missing person by the time this body was located in the over by the Mohican Park.
The autopsy revealed that Margie Coffey had been strangled with her own scarf. The coroner estimated she had been dumped in the creek 10 days earlier, the same day she disappeared. Margie Ramey was her maiden name. She was one of six children who grew up in the heartlands of Ohio on the outskirts of a town named Butler.
And she was an outgoing girl, personal. Well, she was a robust girl, and she loved life. She worked on the farm, and then she would help her mother on the farm. They had a lot of cattle to take care of, and she helped in that.
Margie grew up in a loving, religious home. But in her teenage years, as most kids do, she yearned for independence, began spending most of her time in Mansfield, a larger city about 15 miles northwest of Butler. She made friends with an unsavory crowd.
She got into some activities that were subject to prosecution by the law. And they were mainly street crimes, that type of thing that probably were very low level, but that's how we got to be acquainted with her during our work on the street.
Those street crimes allegedly included prostitution and illegal drug use. Eventually, Margie rejected that life. She met a man named Steve Coffey. The two married and had a daughter, Angie. But the marriage soured, and Margie and Steve divorced. To support herself and her daughter, Margie worked as a waitress. She also enrolled in college to study law enforcement. And during this time, Margie had another child out of wedlock. This time, a son, Brandon. Police investigating her murder wondered if Margie had returned to the streets to support her children.
Well, I know her family helped her some, but she didn't make a lot of money in going to school. Working in a restaurant.
As police knew from experience, life on the streets meant special dangers and a large pool of potential suspects.
Get away!
Maybe there's somebody in her past that has a reason to want her dead. Maybe she's done something or not paid something. Maybe some street person has come to this conclusion that they ought to kill her.
With no suspects or leads, police hoped that the rushing water of Possum Run Creek had not washed away evidence which could lead them to Margie's killer. When 32-year-old Margie Coffey was found strangled in a frozen creek, police wondered if her past had finally caught up with her.
In her particular case, since she had a background of some activity that was certainly against the law, we looked into that possibility that she may have slipped back into that drug environment.
But friends said that wasn't the case. Margie had been focusing her attention on her family and her education.
They were just adamant that they had not seen her, she hadn't been around, and to their knowledge, she had completely cleaned up all of her past activities.
Margie was raising, taking care of the children on her own, and she loved her children. She loved them. She really loved them. And I feel that Margie was a good mother. I really do.
She had also rediscovered religion.
I believe she wanted to be a Christian lady. From all that I could gather from her, that's what she was striving for. To be better, to live better, to act better, and forget all about anything in the past.
Police learned that Margie had been actively dating since her divorce. Among the men she was seeing were two Mansfield police officers, both of whom were married. One was Robert Lemon, a veteran of the force.
He indicated to us that it had ended sometime before that, probably a year and a half minimum, and that he had not had any contact with her and even spoken to her for any reason.
The other was Lieutenant Charles Oswald. He too said his relationship with Margie was over.
Lieutenant Oswald was very much in love with his wife. oftentimes spoke about what they did on weekends and things like that. He was a type of police officer that other police officers, I would say, would try to emulate.
Lieutenant Oswald furnished a police report indicating he had been on duty that night on a drug investigation. The trail of Margie's killer was growing cold.
We had no fingerprints, we had no weapon, we had explored the other possibilities, and those possibilities really were going to come from her.
Margie Coffey was last seen alive at this diner, sitting in a booth with her school books open, studying for a class. Detective David Messmore interviewed the owner of the diner, who said that Lieutenant Oswald was in the diner the same time as Margie. The two weren't sitting together, but they did acknowledge one another.
It was a very distressing situation. Not only did I work with him, I knew he was a very good policeman, but I'd been friends with him. And it was very upsetting to me to think that he might have been involved in a crime like that.
When confronted with this information, Lieutenant Oswald refused to comment. Margie's parents laid their daughter to rest. An excruciating task few parents are prepared for.
Margie's parents, Mr. and Mrs. Ramey, suffered from that day on. There was times that they would just break down and cry when they would see a picture of Margie, or when Mrs. Ramey would talk to me.
Little did police realize that Margie's own son would provide a tantalizing clue, one that would lead them to the killer. As the search for Margie Coffey's killer continued, a Mansfield police officer told homicide investigators about a suspicious incident that occurred the night Margie was killed. The officer said he saw Lieutenant Charles Oswald, who had been linked romantically to Margie, on foot, out of uniform, and behaving strangely near the police station.
And he had a leather jacket on, which would be unusual at that time of the night due to the fact that he was working.
This officer said, "What's going on? How you doing?" And he kind of ignored him. And he continued on walking into the police department through the back way.
Oswald's behavior cast doubt on his claim that he was investigating a drug operation that night.
For him to be nervous and excited in that period of time was kind of unusual. That kind of took the luster or the punch out of his alibi.
In the forensics lab, Margie Coffey's clothing would soon tell a story of its own.
You had the scarf, you had leg warmers, you had a heavy coat. Once the clothing is dry, basically it'll be hung on a hanger, just like your clothing would be at home. There'll be a piece of paper placed underneath in case anything naturally falls off. And then the article is simply held and scraped with a spatula all the way down to help lift these articles off and let them fall onto the paper to be collected.
While most of the trace evidence had been washed away by the water, a very small amount remained.
We recovered a number of hairs and fibers, in particular two fibers, red in color. The presence of these two fibers, about a quarter of an inch in length and no more than twice the size of a human hair across, were all we had to really work with.
While different fibers may look similar to the naked eye, under a microscope, they are very distinctive. The foreign fibers on Margie's coat and leg warmers were triangular in shape, or trilobal. From the side, this trilobal shape gives the appearance of having a stripe running along the side. Trilobal carpet is usually found in high traffic areas like hotels and automobile interiors, since it hides dirt. Tony Tambasco took carpet samples from every location where Margie had been in the days before her murder. Tambasco thought he found what he was looking for in the home of Margie's parents.
And at Margie's parents' house, we found a floor mat that actually had red carpet. The red carpet fibers in the floor mat looked very similar to those that we had recovered from the victim.
But under a microscope, that carpet was not similar to the fibers on Margie's clothes. Since Lieutenant Oswald was seen in the diner with Margie on the night she disappeared, Tambasco wanted to examine the police cruiser Oswald had been driving that night. Most police vehicles are not carpeted because of heavy use and have rubber flooring instead. But police records revealed that on the night in question, Lieutenant Oswald was the watch commander, and the watch commander's vehicle was different from the others.
The unique thing about that particular cruiser, cruiser number 306, was it was a supervisor's car. It wasn't your standard police car that you buy every year with the fleet. It was bought at a public auction.
The Mansfield police had gone to an auction, had purchased a Chevy Caprice Classic, a full-size car for their commanders. And of course, the upper echelon of the police department have a little nicer vehicle than the guys in the street.
The carpet in the watch commander's car was red. Tambasco took a small sample from the vehicle. At first, it looked similar to the carpet in Margie's parents' house. But under a microscope, the fibers told a different story and were similar in all respects to the fibers found on Margie's clothing.
We looked at color. You can see the color's the same. We looked at diameter. You can see the diameter is consistent. We looked at the trilobal design, and the pattern does show that.
Chemical tests revealed that both sets of fibers had been dyed with the same chemicals. But fiber evidence, unlike DNA or a fingerprint, is not definitive.
The presence of the fibers being consistent with the fibers in the vehicle is not an identification to the exclusion of all others. It's not an absolute. There's no way anyone should come to court, and there's no way anyone can come to court and testify that that fiber came from that carpet. It's just not going to happen.
But even more damning evidence against Officer Oswald would come from Margie's 6-year-old son, Brandon. The circumstantial evidence in Margie Coffey's murder all pointed to Lieutenant Charles Oswald. So did the forensic evidence. The two red carpet fibers on Margie's clothing were microscopically similar to the carpet in Oswald's automobile. But the question haunting police was motive. If Oswald murdered Margie Coffey, why did he do it? After Margie had given birth to her second child, Brandon, she told social services that she couldn't identify the baby's father since the pregnancy was the result of a rape. But later, when she applied for financial aid at college, she was required to identify Brandon's father and explain why she wasn't receiving child support.
When she became a Jehovah's Witness, and they began to counsel with her, they found these details out, they said, look, you can't lie. You're to tell the truth.
And she named Chuck Oswald as the father.
With this news, prosecutors asked Oswald to undergo a paternity test. It revealed that the likelihood of Oswald being Brandon's father was greater than 99%. Investigators also discovered that Oswald had refused to pay for child support when Margie asked, possibly because he didn't want his wife to find out about his infidelity.
Lieutenant Oswald was married, had children. In fact, up until all of this broke, his wife didn't know anything about Margie Coffey, did not know that he had a child by another woman. And so I'm sure that her finding that out certainly was motive for what happened.
Oswald allegedly offered Margie a few thousand dollars from an insurance settlement, which Margie refused as insufficient. During Charles Oswald's murder trial, prosecutors presented one more piece of evidence against him. A woman who had once worked for police as a decoy in prostitution investigations, Charlene Dry Sawyer, testified that she, too, had been having an affair with Oswald. Sawyer claimed that Oswald had not only told her he murdered Margie Coffey, he also provided details of the crime. Sawyer said that after Oswald and Margie saw one another in the diner, they went to Oswald's police car to talk. They discussed the child support matter and Oswald's offer of $3,000 to end the dispute.
Take the $3,000 and get out.
No, it's not enough.
With Margie's refusal, the conversation grew heated and Margie threatened to disclose that Oswald was Brandon's father.
I will file a lawsuit and your wife and kids will find out about this.
Slut!
Margie slapped him. Oswald responded by strangling her with her own scarf. The forensic evidence reveals that Oswald put Margie's lifeless body in the back seat of his police car, where her coat and leg warmers picked up the tiny red triangular-shaped carpet fibers. Later, prosecutors say Oswald drove to the bridge over Possum Run Creek and dumped the body into the water in the mistaken belief that any incriminating evidence would be washed downstream.
You know, when it's yellow and it waddles and it quacks, it's probably a duck. And that's the case that we had here.
At his trial, Lieutenant Oswald took the stand in his own defense and denied killing Margie Coffey. He repeated his claim that he had been working alone that night on a drug investigation and offered the type police report to prove it. But prosecutors contended that the report was bogus, implying that Oswald himself had typed the phony report after the murder to give himself an alibi. The jury found Lieutenant Charles Oswald guilty of voluntary manslaughter and abusing a corpse. He was sentenced to 10 to 25 years in prison. To this day, Oswald insists he did not kill Margie Coffey.
He may deny it, and he may go to the grave denying it. I think he is guilty. Now, if I'm wrong, God forgive me.
For residents of Mansfield, the ultimate betrayal is a policeman who commits murder.
I mean, it's bad enough to murder someone. But then when you're supposed to be protecting people and then using the office of authority to kill someone, then that's the lowest murder that I can think of.
He will never, ever, ever admit that crime. I don't care if they keep him in jail till he dies. He will go to his grave with that in his mind. He will never, ever. And I really believe that.
Prosecutors say that it was solid police work and some luck that helped seal the case.
The presence of these red fibers in that carpet was simply a shot in the dark. A police car in our own backyard, a police car in our fleet. The uniqueness of that police car being bought at auction, the chance of that, one in a million.
And without the forensic evidence, Lieutenant Oswald might not have been brought to justice.
I'd say this was one of the key pieces of evidence, and it would have been more difficult for a jury to have convicted him, if not impossible.
We'll be right back. In 1991, a high school girl vanished after attending a party. Her abandoned vehicle was found in a school parking lot near her home. The prime suspect had not one, but two alibi witnesses for the night she disappeared. A solid alibi can often overcome much circumstantial evidence. But forensic evidence is another matter. On a Saturday night in November of 1991, 17-year-old Crystal Faye Todd was dropped off in a mall parking lot after attending a party. Since Crystal didn't have to be home for another hour, she said she was going to get something to eat before heading home. It was the last time Crystal was seen alive. When she wasn't home by 1 a.m., her mother contacted police.
Horry County Police, may I help you?
She also called Crystal's best friend, Ken Register, who said he hadn't seen Crystal all night.
After I talked to Ken Register, I called one of my friends, and he got up out of bed and come in. We went all over Conway hunting her, see if we could find her car anywhere.
They found her car the next morning in a nearby school parking lot. Her purse and coat were inside.
I don't know why I had to feed it. It's just something come over me that somebody had Crystal.
17-year-old Crystal Faye Todd was a senior in high school living in the small tobacco farming town of Conway, South Carolina.
I was 39 when she was born. She was a miracle to me. And I just couldn't believe I had her. I was proud of her too.
Crystal's dad died when she was very young. But she grew up as a happy child, active in her church, sung in the youth group choir, and dreamt of going to college.
She was very lively, good personality, good humor, very outgoing. Just loved to be with her friends, hanging out, having a good time.
Just a few hours after Crystal's abandoned car was found in a school parking lot, two hunters in a remote field noticed a trail of blood. It led to a nearby ditch. There lay a woman's body with multiple stab wounds and partially disrobed.
It was brutal, and it's a scene that will be with me for a long time.
It was sexual in nature. It wasn't a murder just to murder someone. There was sexual gratification.
On the victim's finger was a high school ring. Engraved on the inside was the name Crystal Todd.
I just wish it could have been me instead of her. I'd lived a long time. She hadn't lived no time.
Investigators thought the perpetrator might have been from outside the area, but forensic evidence at the crime scene pointed much closer to home.
Well, I don't really have a life anymore. I just exist. I go from one day to the next, and I don't even want to get up out of bed and face another day. It's just horrible. It don't get any better.
Residents of Conway, South Carolina, were appalled by Crystal Faye Todd's senseless murder. Medical examiner Dr. Jamie Downs performed the autopsy.
She did have the defense injury to the left hand because we thought that odd at the time. why would someone have defended themselves with their left hand? She was right-handed. Why not use her right hand or dominant hand?
The answer was discovered soon enough. One of the stab wounds penetrated the left side of her skull, which would have immediately paralyzed her right side.
What does a defense wound tell you? It tells you the victim was conscious. It tells you the victim was not bound. It tells you the victim was cognizant of danger.
Some of the wounds didn't cause bleeding, an indication they were made after death.
The victim is completely dead. The victim is no longer struggling, yet the offender still had enough anger that he incised or cut the body after death.
In all, she was stabbed 31 times.
The term that we use is overkill. That's more wounding than is necessary to take someone's life.
When Dr. Downs measured the wounds, he concluded that the murder weapon was a 3.5-inch knife, the type with a blade that locks in place. It would have had to be a locking blade, or it couldn't have penetrated the skull. Forensic evidence confirmed she had been sexually assaulted, and that she was murdered on one side of the road and the body dumped on the other.
Well, what it told me is that he was panicking and he simply wanted to disassociate himself from the crime. It told me that he probably had never killed before and he was inexperienced in this type of crime.
In search for suspects, investigators first looked through Crystal's personal papers. On one of Crystal's school notebooks was the name Andy Tindall written on the cover. Friends say Crystal met Tindall through a mutual acquaintance. Tindall was a 31-year-old convicted thief wanted in Alabama for a parole violation. Police also discovered that he had a taste for high school girls.
No doubt about it, we thought we had our man. He fit what we were looking for.
Forensic scientists evaluated the rape test kit from Crystal's autopsy and discovered that the killer had type O blood with an extremely rare blood subtype characterized by the enzyme PGM.
It stands for phosphoglucomutase. That is an enzyme that is stable in body fluids from individuals. The blood type, the secretor status, and the PGM subtype made him approximately 2% of the population.
And the DNA profile of the perpetrator was highly unusual as well.
We found that the profile was in fact rare and occurred with a frequency of approximately 1 in 250 million Caucasians and 1 in 1.5 billion blacks.
Surprisingly, this forensic information exonerated their prime suspect, Andy Tindall. More than 1,000 people attended Crystal Faye Todd's funeral. Crystal's best friends served as her pallbearers. Her grieving mother and police appealed to the community for any information about the crime. In response, a resident of Conway came forward to say he had driven by the school parking lot on the night Crystal disappeared and saw Crystal's car with a man and a woman standing beside it. Now police had another lead. A police sketch of his description looked to many like Crystal's mother, Bonnie, and her boyfriend.
There's no question in my mind as I sit here today that the individual in that sketch was Bonnie Faye Todd's boyfriend.
Police wondered just how much Crystal's mother knew about the murder. A witness told police that on the night Crystal disappeared, he had seen two people standing near Crystal's car in the parking lot. His description matched Crystal's mother and her mother's boyfriend. But when questioned further, The witness admitted he had been drinking that night and may have seen Crystal's mother on Sunday morning when she and her boyfriend found Crystal's car.
I thought it was awful. Yet, much as I love my daughter, to even try to blame it on me.
With Bonnie no longer a suspect, and their previous suspect, Andy Tindall, exonerated by DNA testing, investigators had no other leads. So police commissioned a behavioral profile of the killer.
Well, criminal behavior profiling is when you have an unsolved case and you study the crime and the behavior of the offender during the commission of the crime and you arrive at characteristics. It's a subjective opinion. You arrive at characteristics and traits of the unidentified offender, such as age, race, marital status, arrest history, educational level, things of that nature.
The profile suggested that Crystal's killer was a white male in his early 20s and was a friend of Crystal's who lived within 3 miles of her home. The young man was angry and probably had a police record. He was physically strong. Above all, the profile suggested that he was confident he would never be considered a suspect. Since the profile suggested that the killer was one of Crystal's friends, police asked her male classmates and acquaintances to voluntarily give blood samples for DNA testing. Despite the challenge to their civil liberties, 52 men complied.
It wasn't, well, anything's voluntary, but they still had a pool of names that they were pulling from. And, you know, and then when they pulled the name, then they would ask if you would go down and give the DNA test or give the specimen. And everybody volunteered. It was, I haven't heard of anybody not doing it.
Incredibly, one of those DNA profiles matched the DNA of the perpetrator, donor number 44. When investigators asked Crystal's mother to name the one person she would least expect to hurt her daughter, she identified the same man.
He says, who do you trust her with, day or night, any time, anywhere that she won't date? And I said, Ken Register.
Ken Register and Crystal Todd had known each other since childhood. Their relationship wasn't romantic, they were simply very good friends. They spoke together almost every day, and it was Ken whom Mrs. Todd first called for help on the night Crystal disappeared. Ken had also been one of Crystal's pallbearers. When police checked Ken Register's background, they discovered two troubling pieces of information. First, he had an explosive temper, and he also had a criminal record. Two months earlier, two local college students accused Register of exposing himself when he stopped to ask for directions.
I'm lost. I'm looking for the library. Can you help me out here?
Ew!
3 years before that, as a 15-year-old, Register was caught making obscene telephone calls to this woman in which he described in detail how he wanted to assault and murder her.
He said he would slit me wide open and many other graphic descriptions.
The murder Register described in these calls was identical to the murder of Crystal Faye Todd.
Exactly where were you the night that Crystal died?
But Ken Register was flabbergasted when told his blood DNA matched Crystal's killer. He asked police rhetorically why he would have agreed to a blood test if he was the killer. When police searched Register's car, they could find no evidence linking him to the crime scene. Register also had an alibi. His girlfriend said he was with her at this go-kart track that night, and his mother said Ken was home by 12:30.
That alibi was about as strong as you're gonna get. Very surprising to me. And it's always compelling evidence.
I know where I was at, when I was at there that night, right here at my house, and I know when he came home.
Although Ken Register's mother was his alibi witness, she would later play a key role in solving Crystal Todd's murder. Crystal Todd's best friend, Ken Register, was now the prime suspect in her murder. His DNA matched the DNA found at the crime scene, but he insisted he was innocent and provided two alibi witnesses, his girlfriend and his mother. Ken had been a regular guest in Crystal's home, but Mrs. Todd said she knew nothing about his criminal past.
If I'd have known about the indecent exposure and the threatening phone calls, Ken Register would never put his foot in my house. But I didn't find out about it until it was too late.
And Mrs. Todd now reveals something her daughter told her, which may hint at the motive.
In a week and a half before she was killed, she said, "Mama Ken still wanted me to date him." I said, "Well, he must think of Lord Evie and him as a girlfriend." "Yeah," she said, "that's all he wanted was sex." And I said, "Well, don't go with him then."
"Okay, Ken, let's go over this again."
During police questioning, Ken Register denied any involvement in the murder. But towards the end of a six-hour interrogation, police told him his mother had sent him a message.
"Thank you." "Ken, it's a note from your mother. Mother says to tell us exactly what happened and to be truthful about it. And if you do, your mother says everything will be okay."
And with that, Ken Register confessed.
"I did it."
He said he saw Crystal around midnight at a traffic light near the school parking lot.
"Hey, Crystal. Hey,
hey,
what's up?
Hey.
How are you? Hey, good. Listen, you want to go hang out or do something for a little bit?"
"Yeah, cool. All right. Wait, just let me go park."
"All right, I'll follow you."
"Okay."
Crystal got into his car. They drove to a deserted location where Register said the two had consensual sex. The forensic evidence suggests it wasn't consensual at all.
"What, no condom? Are you stupid? Oh my God. Look, Ken, I'm telling you right now, if I get pregnant, I'm telling everybody you raped me." "Don't blow it off. I'm serious. Asshole."
When she got out of the car to get dressed, Register said he grabbed the hunting knife from the car and killed her. Further sexual activity took place after death.
I don't think Crystal Faye Todd did anything that night to cause her death, other than the mere fact she got in the car with him.
Prosecutors believe that Register cleaned his car sometime after the crime to remove possible evidence.
The evidence had been systematically destroyed before we realized that he was a suspect.
In Register's home, police found an empty box, a box for a knife with a locking blade. Forensic scientists determined that the missing knife would have been similar to the weapon used to inflict Crystal's stab wounds. Before the trial, Register recanted his confession, saying it was coerced. He said police lied to him about the contents of his mother's note. But lying to a suspect during a police interrogation is perfectly legal.
"There's no doubt in my mind that Mr. Register brutally and viciously killed Crystal Faye Todd. And there's also no doubt in my mind that he enjoyed doing it."
"I mean, there was just too much time unaccounted for. He had plenty, ample time to do everything that he was accused of and still be home when he said he got home."
But why convicted register willingly give a blood sample for DNA testing if he was the perpetrator. Published reports say that when police requested a DNA sample, Ken Register asked, "What is DNA?" At the time, DNA testing had been used in criminal cases for about 5 years, but Register was apparently unfamiliar with it since it hadn't yet been used in the state of South Carolina. His case was the first. Ken Register was convicted of murder, kidnapping, and sexual assault. He was sentenced to life in prison, plus 35 years.
They found him guilty. I was glad they found him guilty now. I was proud of that. But I want him to get literature.
Mental job, psycho. I don't know what's wrong, but something's not clicking to where it's supposed to be clicking.
Ken Register and his family still say he is innocent, but several subsequent DNA tests have all confirmed the original findings.
I know what I know because I know I was home that night, and I know when he came home. I can't explain the DNA. I wished I could. There's so many questions in this that you can't explain.
Based on everything that I know about the violence of this crime, and is that when he left the scene of that murder, he would have been a bloody mess.
I think there's a lot of covering up going on in that house. She seen him covered in blood all over, and I know he was covered in blood all over. He had to be. And if she helped clean him up, she got crystal blood on her hands too.
Bonnie Faye Todd visits Crystal's grave faithfully, and she thanks science for bringing Crystal's killer to justice.
I love you more than I do my own life.
Without the DNA and the blood, we would have never gotten to first base, probably never even made an arrest.
That's scary.
Yeah.
A young woman vanished from her home on an island in rural Canada. Thousands of police, army, and local residents spent months searching for her.
Hey, Alpha!
This is the story of how one tiny white hair solved the mystery of her disappearance while adding a new chapter to the history of forensic science.
Violent things going on because people are very much down to earth and everybody knows everyone because we're a small community. There's not a very large population on the island, you know.
On October 7, 1994, a woman called police to report an abandoned car in a field near her house. The license plates were missing, and when police looked inside, they saw what looked to be a crime scene.
There were blood stains, small specks of blood on the windshield, on the inside of the windshield, on the side windows of the vehicle inside.
These dots indicate the location of blood inside the car. Forensic scientists identified the blood as medium impact blood spatter, the type caused when someone is hit with an object, like a fist. The serial number of the vehicle identified the owner as a local woman, 32-year-old Shirley Duguay. Shirley was a stay-at-home mother of five children, the oldest 15, the youngest 8-year-old twins. Shirley and her children were living in this home, now abandoned, in the small town of Richmond. Her father, Melvin, had been watching the children since Shirley disappeared 4 days earlier.
Well, we found it very odd that no one had reported her missing initially. And of course, it raised some suspicion with us.
Shirley Duguay had been known in the past to take off for a couple of days and not tell anyone where she had gone and then return.
Police suspected it was Shirley's blood in the car. The pillow she sat on while driving was found nearby, soaked in blood.
She was a very small, diminutive person, 4 feet 9 inches tall, less than 100 pounds. So very, very frail looking individual. Other than that, we didn't know too much about her.
To identify the blood, scientists needed a blood sample from Shirley's father, Melvin, for DNA testing. Since Shirley would get half of her DNA from each parent, scientists found that the blood in the car contained 50% of Melvin Duguay's genetic markers, meaning the blood was Shirley's. While examining the blood, forensic scientists found something else. Blood that did not come from Shirley Duguay. Was this the blood of another victim, or possibly the blood of a killer? After Shirley Duguay's car was found abandoned and spattered with blood, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police began one of the largest searches in the history of Prince Edward Island. They checked hundreds of square miles and every waterway in the area.
We used psychics, we used hypnosis. Anything that we could put our hands on or could think of, we used it.
Some of the revelations were very unusual.
Psychics have even told us that she was buried near water, pine trees, shallow grave. But where? You know, you just don't know where to start.
About a half mile away from Shirley's car, police found a shovel with two long black hairs attached. When scientists compared that hair to hair taken from Shirley Duguay's hairbrush, they were microscopically similar. The search for Shirley's body lasted for weeks. Then, investigators came upon a possible clue. 15 miles from Shirley's car, police found a plastic bag with a pair of sneakers and a blood-stained leather jacket inside. The blood on the leather jacket matched Shirley Duguay's DNA profile. But the jacket was a man's size, much too big to belong to Shirley. When police asked Melvin Duguay who might have wanted to harm his daughter, his response was startling.
I would have killed him. I would have killed that guy.
He was talking about Shirley's estranged husband, Doug Beamish, a demolition worker who had been separated from Shirley for the past 18 months.
I think I would have did a good deed if I had shot him, killed him, because she'd be alive today. I'd be in jail, but she'd be alive.
During the couple's on-again, off-again 15-year relationship, police learned that Beamish had physically abused Shirley.
Every woman that lives with an abusive husband or boyfriend or whatever and end up murdered react in the same way. People advise them to not go with them or live with them, but for some reason, they do.
Are you having any issues or problems?
During police questioning, Beamish denied any involvement in Shirley's disappearance.
Where were you on October the 3rd?
Then investigators asked him what size shoes he wore.
9.
The same size as the sneakers found with the bloody leather jacket. Now police wanted to know if Doug Beamish had worn these shoes. So they turned to a forensic podiatrist, Dr. Keith Bettles. Everyone wears shoes differently, mostly because of the variations in size, shape, and mechanics of their feet.
Each individual has a unique way of walking. This ultimately is transmitted to the sole of the feet. which again is transmitted to the inner sole of the shoe and again onto the outside of the shoe as to where they're walking to the wear on that individual's shoe.
With a warrant, police cast Beamish's feet by placing them in styrofoam molds, then poured plaster of Paris inside. Once hardened, the molds can be compared to the wear patterns in a pair of shoes. This computer-generated image shows how these wear patterns are created. The different colors indicate the amount of pressure made by each part of the foot as it touches the inside of the shoe. The feet create marks called pressure points and are unique to each person.
Mr. Beamish's toe was hyperflexed. That means it just turned up a little bit at the end. The nails would be chafing away and rubbing at the inner lining of the shoe.
And Beamish's feet were pronated, meaning they turned inward. When Dr. Bettles cut open the sneakers, he found wear patterns caused by pronated feet and chafing marks in the top of the shoe, like those caused by hyperflexed toes.
After I'd done the examination of the sneakers, I was quite satisfied that these shoes had been worn at the time by Mr. Beamish.
But Doug Beamish denied the sneakers were his. He also denied owning the leather jacket found with the shoes. Inside the jacket, investigators discovered even more evidence. 20 brittle white hairs. Under a microscope, the hairs did not appear to be human. Human hairs have thin medullas, the cord that runs through the center of the hair. These hairs had thick medullas, meaning they were animal hairs. But what animal? Constable Roger Savoy thought he had an answer. He remembered something from his interview with Doug Beamish. It was the type of observation we make hundreds of times each day, but usually forget.
Well, what's there to tell?
Savoy recalled that he saw a cat in Doug Beamish's home. But it wasn't just any cat. It was a pure white one. A cat Beamish called Snowball. Savoy also recalled that the cat rubbed up against his leg during his visit, leaving a number of white hairs on his trousers. Hairs that looked identical to the ones found in the bloody leather jacket. Investigators now wondered whether there was any way to prove scientifically whether the cat hairs on the leather jacket belonged to Snowball. ...33-year-old Shirley Duguay was still missing, but a leather jacket stained with her blood was found 15 miles from her abandoned car. Police believe the leather jacket was the key to her disappearance.
The person involved in Shirley's death was likely wearing that jacket because it was not Shirley's jacket. So we had to put the jacket on somebody. We had to prove that jacket belonged to someone.
Inside the jacket were several brittle white hairs, which were suspected to be from Doug Beamish's cat.
If we could prove that it was this particular cat's hair, then we would be able to say that this belonged to Mr. Beamish, the jacket. And the job was to find someone that could do this type of testing.
Savoy made hundreds of telephone calls and found, to his surprise, that forensic testing on cat hair had never been done before anywhere in the world.
Why'd you look at some DNA testing for us?
But he was fortunate enough to come across Dr. Stephen O'Brien, a geneticist at the National Cancer Institute in the United States who had spent decades studying hereditary illness in cats.
The constable said to me on the phone, Dr. O'Brien, I've looked all over the country, in fact, all over the world, for an expert in cat DNA technology, because I would like very much to know whether or not the hairs that were in the lining of the jacket which are tied to the scene of the crime because the jacket was covered with the victim's blood. Are those hairs from Snowball?
Dr. O'Brien asked Canadian police for a blood sample from Mr. Beamish's cat. But this was more difficult than expected. Snowball wasn't at all cooperative.
It took approximately half an hour from chasing the cat from under the beds to every room in the house until it was almost like the cat knew that we were taking him in.
Roger Savoy told me he went down to the house and read out the rights, the cat's rights, to the parents. And I said to Roger, what did the cat say? And he said, meow.
There's an old saying with the RCMP, we always get our man, but this case we had to go to say we always get our cat.
After finally capturing the cat, Snowball was taken to a local veterinarian's office for the necessary blood sample. Dr. Jane Bond drew the blood as two Canadian officers stood by to take custody of the sample in order to preserve the chain of evidence. Snowball's blood and cat hairs taken from the leather jacket were delivered in person to Dr. O'Brien and his team. One of the hairs contained a root, which was cut into pieces and put into a buffer solution, which dissolved everything except the DNA. It was then amplified or photocopied, so scientists had enough for their tests. The DNA profile of the hair found in the leather jacket was then compared to the DNA from Snowball's blood.
We got a very clear match between the genotype of each of the markers in the hair to each of the same markers in Snowball. And the only way that that could have happened is that they came from the same cat.
But Prince Edward Island is isolated, and there are thousands of cats there. Was it possible, because of inbreeding, isolation, or just plain feline promiscuity, that another cat on the island had the same genetic profile as Snowball? If so, the DNA match would be useless.
You need to know that some other cat on Prince Edward Island couldn't have contributed that hair. What if 25% of the cats on Prince Edward Island had the same DNA profile, or 10%, or even 1 in 100 cats? So that's the next question you have to ask. What is the frequency of that profile?
Blood samples were taken from 20 cats on Prince Edward Island and sent to Dr. O'Brien and his team. The DNA profiles of these 20 cats showed a rich genetic diversity. The chance that the cat hair found on the leather jacket belonged to a cat other than Snowball was estimated to be 1 in 70 million. This was the break Canadian investigators had been hoping for. And then, after 7 months of searching, a fisherman found the last piece of evidence. Twenty-eight weeks into Shirley Duguay's disappearance, a fisherman along Canada's Armoire River saw a pile of brush on the riverbank that looked out of place. As he moved the brush away, he saw what appeared to be a human body.
It was a very shallow grave, dug just deep enough to cover the body. The person was a very tiny person. We knew Shirley Duguay was less than 5 feet tall, less than 100 pounds. Obviously, we expected it was Shirley Duguay.
I was alone by myself, and it started to snow. It was a freak snowstorm and I recall all I had on was a rain jacket, and I felt bad because the body was partly uncovered, so I took my rain jacket, which was all I had to keep warm, and put it on top of the grave to keep the snow off her.
Ironically, Shirley's body was buried in a spot nearly identical to what the police psychic predicted. Near the water, under pine trees.
It was just lucky that they found her when they did, because the police told me that within 2 or 3 weeks more, and they would have had a hard time to identify her because the ground was thawing out.
They knew that there was very little hope of finding her alive, and when they found her, they were very relieved in the sense that they knew at least that they could have a service for her and pray and get together, and they could sort of bring a closure to it.
At the autopsy, the cause of death was determined to be blunt force trauma. Just as the blood spatter in her car suggested, Shirley's nose was broken and her jaw broken in three places. One of her front teeth was found embedded in her lung. Doug Beamish was arrested and charged with murder. Scientists discovered that it was his blood mixed with Shirley's inside her abandoned car. But what was his motive? Police discovered Beamish had written Shirley a letter threatening to kill her before he'd allow her to get custody of their children.
The whole letter was written in blood. It was just one page, mind you, but it was written in blood.
Although Beamish denied owning the leather jacket stained with Shirley's blood, police found this photograph taken the day before Shirley's disappearance. In it, he is wearing a jacket identical to the one found at the crime scene.
Actually, he has no defense at all, except to say I didn't do it. But I think if he interviewed all the prisoners in the prisons in Canada, they'd all say I didn't do it. That's pretty well. They've always got someone else to blame on. You know, criminals do that. They always blame someone else for their problems. You never see a criminal go in court and say, I did it, Judge.
After going to great lengths to cover up the crime, Beamish never realized that petting his cat before the murder would be his downfall.
One in three criminals have cats, and maybe one in four have a dog. So when you go to the scene of the crime, and if there's a trace of DNA there, it's like leaving your name, your rank, and social security number, which can be used. And failing to have the individuals, if they leave their pets' parts there, that can implicate them too. This is what happened with Mr. Beamish. His pet cat implicated him.
Doug Beamish was tried and convicted of Shirley Duguay's murder and sentenced to 18 years in prison. The case is among the most celebrated in forensic history because it is the first time that animal DNA was used to convict a murderer.
Since then, we've received calls from, after the investigation, from all over the world. Literally, I received calls from Japan asking us how this worked. How did the animal DNA work?
I mean, I was actually surprised once the Snowball case became well known among the forensic community. I would say about once every 2 weeks, I would receive a phone call from a police department that was investigating a crime where an animal hair had been left behind, and they were asking us to help them.
T.S. Eliot penned these lines in his old Possum's Book of Practical Cats. You now have learned enough to see that cats are much like you and me. We've learned that applies to their DNA too. And Doug Beamish now wishes that this wasn't true. In a small town in Oregon in 1984, the first biological attack was launched against the United States. For over a decade, the details of this nearly catastrophic event were withheld from the public. This is how forensic science unearthed the biological trail. This small town in Oregon is called The Dalles and is perched high above the Columbia River, about 80 miles due east of Portland.
It seems like you've driven back in the 50s. And it seems, in the physical appearance, it seems frozen in time in that way.
Dave and Sandy Lutkins are among the 11,000 residents who find The Dalles the perfect place to raise a family.
A half an hour or an hour from skiing, a lot of water sports, a lot of hiking. It has pretty decent schools. We have pretty low crime.
On September 25th, 1984, David and Sandy both became violently ill with cramps, diarrhea, and vomiting. Their dehydration caused delirium.
But I'd never felt that bad in my life. The room was spinning, and you just didn't care about anything.
Well, let's put it this way. I would never want to be that sick again.
When David and his wife went to the hospital, they weren't the only ones seriously ill.
And then suddenly there were so many people. We had people laying on the floor. We had people leaning up against the wall. There were people in the lobby.
They all had the same symptoms. Microbiologists identified the cause: Salmonella. Salmonella is a bacteria commonly found in eggs, meat, poultry, unpasteurized milk, water, and in animal feces, especially that of reptiles. It is rarely fatal, but sometimes death occurs in infants and the elderly. 10 days after the first outbreak, a second wave hit. The number of patients exploded from dozens to hundreds. Every hospital bed was filled. By the time Dave Lutkins emerged from 4 days of delirium, he encountered a disaster. Lutkins owned a small restaurant. 13 of his employees were sick, along with hundreds of his customers.
We had virtually no business. I mean, it just disappeared. It was tough. I mean, I was in the process of building another facility in Hood River, and I was going to have it all paid for and opening up debt-free, and it didn't work out that way.
But what was the source of the outbreak? Food handlers who don't properly wash their hands after using the bathroom sometimes transmit Salmonella. But hundreds of people were sick, and they hadn't eaten in the same restaurant or even the same restaurant chain. Tests of the water supply revealed nothing. The Centers for Disease Control in Atlanta, Georgia, was asked to investigate whether it was some type of accidental outbreak, or was it intentional? Solving the riddle of the Salmonella outbreak in Oregon is the job of epidemiologists, scientists who study how disease moves through large populations.
They seem to be unrelated events. Complicated things greatly. It was almost like doing multiple simultaneous investigations.
There seemed to be no common link among the hundreds of residents who had gotten sick. Dave and Sandy Lutkins both remembered eating a salad in their restaurant before getting ill.
I think we were too sick to worry that much about it at that time. It was later that we started, you know, wondering if it was going to close us down.
Hundreds of their customers and most of their employees became ill too. At the county health department, nurse Diane Kirk contacted everyone who fell ill and discovered they had all eaten a salad from one of 10 local restaurants.
Most of the people seemed to have eaten potato salad. At another restaurant, most of the people seemed to have eaten a green salad. And so what was going on?
They looked at common suppliers of food. They looked, you know, where did everybody get their lettuce? Where did everybody get this? Where did everybody get that?
We couldn't find one source of cucumbers or lettuce or of meat or of anything that would explain all those restaurants being contaminated at once.
What do you got here?
Dr. Michael Skiles runs the laboratory that processed samples from the Dale Salmonella outbreak. Microbiologists discovered that all of the victims had the same strain of Salmonella, one that was exceptionally rare.
It was dulcitol negative, which means it didn't biochemically break down a sugar called dulcitol, and that's only the case for 2% of Salmonellas of this type.
This Salmonella had another odd characteristic. Unlike most bacteria, this one was not resistant to antibiotics. When all the cases were tallied, there had been 751 cases of Salmonella poisoning. 10% were restaurant workers.
And these people became ill before outbreaks among the outbreak was noticed among customers.
Nevertheless, 2 months after the outbreak, the state of Oregon reported that poor hygiene of restaurant workers and cross-contamination were the most likely causes of the outbreak. In other words, they didn't know.
The Oregon Health Department basically hung us out and said, well, it was dirty employees. It was, you know, it was unsafe practices, unsafe handling of food.
Officials found no Salmonella in Dave Lutkin's restaurant, but they did find traces of it in some of the other restaurants.
If you've worked in public health long enough, you'll figure out that lots of times you really can't pinpoint where things come from.
The health officials said, this is the best we can tell you. It wasn't a very satisfying explanation for them or for the public or for the press, but at that time there was no other explanation.
Local officials now began to suspect a religious cult outside of town, the Rajneeshis. As the Rajneeshis expanded their compound, there had been growing tension between cult leaders and local politicians. Just a year earlier, one of the cult's leaders, Ma'anan Sheila, hinted at potential violence. She said, quote, we are here in Oregon to stay at whatever the cost. If that means some blood is spilled, then this is the price we are prepared to pay. A guru from India, Bhagwan Sri Rajneesh, started the farming commune in 1981. After 2 years and $30 million, the 64,000-acre organic farming and meditation compound had its own post office, school, hospital, and shopping mall with housing for over 1,000 followers.
There are doctors and lawyers and accountants who've given up everything to drive tractors and plant potatoes and have, you know, daily chants.
As he drove through the compound each day in one of his 80 Rolls-Royce automobiles, the guru preached the benefits of meditation and free love. Published reports say that the Bhagwan claimed to have had more sex partners than anyone in history. In 1982, the Rajneeshis took over the nearby town of Antelope, and with it the majority of seats on the city council and school board, which horrified longtime residents of the small town. Before the outbreak, the Rajneeshis had set their sights on control of the larger town of the Dales and had put up their own slate of candidates running in the November election. In the absence of a scientific explanation, some thought the Rajneeshis might have intentionally poisoned the community in some way.
So there was suspicion, but there was no evidence.
Why would they do this? And the other thought was maybe there was somebody, some hothead, trying to incriminate the Rajneesh.
1 year later, the Rajneeshis' behavior grew even more bizarre, revealing evidence that would eventually solve the mystery. Since health officials could not find the source of the salmonella outbreak in the Dalles, Oregon, suspicion among local officials continued to be the Roshnishis, a religious cult living on a farm outside of town.
My criminals being accused of poisoning someone who we had nothing to do with.
Leaders of the cult and town officials were often at odds. The cult was founded by Bhagwan Sri Rajneesh, but the day-to-day operations were run by his associate, Ma Anand Sheila.
They met each other's needs. Sheila provided for him whatever he wanted. You want 60 Rolls Royces, we'll get you 60 Rolls Royces. You want a new disciple tonight, we'll get you a new disciple. You want to fly in a jet, we'll get you, whatever to make you happy. And the trade-off was that the Bhagwan would say, okay, you're number one, you're in control, you take care of all the details. I don't care how you do it.
The Rajneeshis were becoming paranoid for many reasons. They were being investigated for possible immigration fraud, and there was growing internal conflict between Sheila and other commune leaders.
Nonsense. You better believe me, I'm a tigress.
She and her group were in a power struggle with another group, which we always kind of called the Hollywood faction. They were rich members of the cult, headed up by a lady who was the ex-wife of a Hollywood producer. They had money. They had access to Rajneesh, and Sheila and her group were very paranoid about these people.
The struggle was for control of the guru, the cult, and its finances. Former cult members told of plans to assassinate several local politicians, rival cult members, a United States attorney, and journalist Les Zeitz, in retaliation for some investigative pieces he had written about the group in the local newspaper.
To be told that you're on a hit list for a group that I believed at the time they were capable of, that they're just purely evil folks by that time, was really kind of a chilling way to start the day.
1 year after the salmonella outbreak, without warning, Sheila and the head of the Roshnish Medical Clinic, a nurse named Pooja, fled to Europe. Rajneesh disowned them.
They had turned it into a fascist concentration camp.
Prosecutors heard that Pooja had been experimenting with biological poisons at the clinic, including salmonella. But there was no hard evidence. With the increasing scrutiny, the Bhagwan stepped up the level of personal security.
There were times when he would move from one end of the town to the other, where he would be in a bulletproof limousine. He would have a lead SUV with armed guards in it. He would have a trailing SUV with armed guards in it, and he'd have a Jet Ranger helicopter in the air. We felt we could be confronted by a 45-person private army with fully automatic weapons.
In October of 1985, a federal grand jury issued a 35-page indictment charging the Bhagwan with lying on his visa application and arranging sham marriages so his followers could remain in the United States. When officials planned to search the compound, they asked epidemiologist Dr. Mike Skeels to come along because of fears of biological retaliation.
And as we were going up that road, I was thinking, for a microbiologist, this is going to be a pretty interesting day.
No shots were fired. In the commune's licensed medical center, Skeels found samples of various bacteria, standard testing material for a small clinic.
One of these vials contained salmonella and typhimurium. And I remember at the time thinking, well, they told me to look for salmonella. If I find any, I'm supposed to seize it as evidence. Well, there it is, so I'll seize it. But I wasn't thinking at all that this was related to the outbreak.
Shortly after the raid, Rajneesh left on one of his private jets. He was arrested in North Carolina on the immigration charges. Meanwhile, the CDC tested the salmonella found in the commune's lab using a technique called plasmid profiling. plasmids are sections of free-floating genetic material outside the bacterial chromosome. Bacteria can exchange plasmids, allowing a colony to genetically adapt.
And you would then use the size of the plasmid and some other characteristics of it to see whether it matched the plasmids from other bacteria, mostly the size. And so if you found that you had the same plasmid type, you could assume that these were related or similar strains.
The Salmonella from the Roshnishi's clinic had a plasmid profile similar to the organism from the Dales. And it could be killed by all antibiotics, just like the strain used in the epidemic.
That really was a smoking gun that showed us that the isolate that I found in their clinic and the isolates that we were getting from the people in this outbreak really were the same bacterial strain.
The question remained, why would the Roshnishis poison the residents of this small town? Inside the Roshnishi commune, investigators found evidence connecting the group to the mass salmonella poisonings. And they discovered other bizarre activities. Sheila had installed surveillance devices everywhere in the commune. Every payphone in the town was tapped, and almost every building.
This is the largest incident of wiretapping in the history of the United States. They wired this whole town. They were illegal interceptions. There were thousands of them. They had banks of tape recorders running all the time. It's indescribable.
Most Roshnishis didn't know they were being monitored. It was kept quiet by Sheila and her inner circle, which held their meetings on her round bed.
A bookcase concealed a metal door opening onto a tunnel.
Or in secret rooms, complete with escape tunnels.
The FBI also found a number of manuals for making bombs, doing dirty tricks, and they found a number of articles about bioterrorism or biowarfare.
The Salmonella was the weapon chosen for a power struggle, but not an internal one.
Wait, did I understand you correctly yesterday when you said that you were in fact now going to attempt to take over Wasco County?
That's correct, you understood right.
When the Roshnishis put up their own candidates to run for election for the local county commission, they wanted to make sure their candidates won. To do that, they wanted to make the local voters sick enough so they couldn't get to the polling places to vote.
The Roshnishis would have enough people in Antelope and other nearby places that they would all vote, 100% turnout among the Roshnishis, enough that they would install their own candidates on the county commission.
But why had the outbreak happened in September? Informants say it was a rehearsal, and it wasn't their first. At Sheila's direction, the Roshnishis took off their red robes and put on regular clothing and went through the town with spray containers filled with salmonella. In August, their first experiment was spraying the door handles in the county courthouse and produce in the local supermarkets. But no one got sick. Their second experiment in September was to spray salmonella on salad bars in 10 local restaurants, which worked, contaminating over 700 residents. Just before election day, the Roshnishis made plans to contaminate the city's water supply. Apparently, they were unsuccessful.
There was evidence that someone had gotten to the reservoir for the city of the Dalles and gotten into it, but no evidence that they actually ever contaminated.
All of the Roshnishi candidates lost in the November elections. Armed with the forensic biological evidence, Sheila and Pooja were extradited from Europe and charged with tampering with consumer products. They both pled guilty, served less than 3 years in federal prison, were released, and fled to Switzerland before state charges could be filed.
Last we knew, Sheila was in Europe running the equivalent of a nursing home, which is sort of chilling to think about, turning grandma over to Sheila in her final days.
There was no proof Rushneesh himself ever knew anything about the Salmonella plot. He pleaded guilty to immigration violations, was deported, and died in India in 1990. Most of the restaurants targeted in the attack never recovered from the economic blow and went out of business. That's what happened to Dave Lutkin's restaurant.
We never regained the position we had in the community afterwards. I had people that would tell me that, you know, I know it wasn't your fault, but I just can't eat there anymore.
He now runs a catering service. The scientists who investigated the outbreak wrote a paper about it. But the Centers for Disease Control asked that it not be published, fearing copycat crimes. In 1997, 13 years after the outbreak, when bioterrorism had become a growing concern, the paper was finally published in the Journal of the American Medical Association. Evidence discovered in the Rushneesh's health clinic revealed they had even more potent biological weapons in their possession. Had they been used, the results would have been catastrophic.
Neither the epidemiology alone nor a criminal investigation alone would have cracked this. It took both to put it together.
Ernestine Perea was found dead in her bedroom of a single gunshot wound. The gun was by her side. After examining the forensic evidence, her death was ruled a homicide. But could that same evidence be interpreted differently? One man's life hung in the balance. In 1979, Martin Friaz entered the United States illegally from Mexico looking for work.
More opportunity, the right to family, better way to, you know, educate your kids, a better life.
Friaz landed a job at a local marble processing plant in the rural town of Wheatland, Wyoming. 2 years later, he met 24-year-old Ernestine Perea, a divorcee with a young daughter. They had two children of their own, a boy and a girl.
She was a good dancer. We danced together good. She was somebody you want to be with.
Ernestine and Martin decided to live together and rented a mobile home on the edge of town. But they also fought, mostly over insignificant matters, says Martin. On July 5th, 1984, Ernestine spent the entire day out with her children and didn't arrive home until 10:30 that night. Martin put the children to bed while Ernestine went to sleep in the couple's bedroom. That night, Friaz slept on a sofa bed in the living room. Around 1 o'clock in the morning, Frias was awakened by one of the children crying.
She was like saying, "Mommy, mommy, get up." Turned the light on, and that's when I saw she was laying in a row, right there on the floor. She had the gun next to her.
Ernestine was dead from a gunshot wound.
I see blood in her stomach. You know, when I was walking out with rain, I saw also blood splattered on the wall. So I called for ambulance, called the police.
There was no evidence of a break-in. There was no evidence of anybody else being out at the trailer other than two small children, I believe a four-year-old and a baby.
When questioned at the scene, Frias lied, saying he wasn't home when Ernestine was shot. Frias may have had reason to lie. Police records showed that the sheriff had been called to his home several times for domestic disturbances. On a number of occasions, Ernestine said that Martin had hit her. A forensic analysis revealed that Frias's fingerprints were all over the rifle, and there was more evidence, even more damning. When Ernestine Perea was found dead of a gunshot wound, her common-law husband, Martin Frias, denied he was home when the shooting occurred. But he later changed his story and admitted he was home that night. Investigators discovered that Ernestine was with some male friends earlier on the day she died.
She had been wrestling in the grass. She'd been drinking with these friends. And also that Martin Frias had evidently ridden by the park at that time and very possibly may have seen them.
Frias said Ernestine had come home drunk. Tests prove this correct. Her blood alcohol level was 0.26, 2.5 times the legal limit. He also said they weren't getting along and had stopped sleeping together.
We knew there had been problems between the two of them. He was sleeping out on the couch in the living room at that time. He'd been banished from the bedroom.
Although he said he was sleeping down the hall, he claimed he never heard the gun go off.
He told investigators he was sleeping on the couch at the other end of the hallway in the trailer. And at some time during the night, about the time when it's believed that the gun went off, he said he heard what he thought to be a twig breaking at night. And he heard that, and then he went back to sleep.
Frias said Ernestine committed suicide. Next to Ernestine's body was a high-powered 300 Magnum hunting rifle which belonged to Frias. His fingerprints were on the rifle. Ernestine's fingerprint was found on the scope. Her pants were ripped near the zipper, and the button had been pulled off, indicating some sort of struggle. Ernestine had a large wound in her abdomen and a much smaller wound in her back. Since exit wounds are generally larger than entrance wounds, the coroner was certain that Ernestine had been shot in the back.
The bullet had entered through a wound which was a little less than half inch in size, had struck the vertebrae, had gone through the body, and had come out through the abdomen on the front side.
Also supporting the homicide theory was the evidence on Ernestine's blouse.
On the inside of the shirt, there were copious amounts of course, blood and tissue, but I also found bone fragments and lead fragments from the bullet as it was disintegrating, passing through the body.
Proof, Dr. Stone says, that Ernestine was shot from behind. The autopsy results found the same thing.
The results of that autopsy confirmed that the bullet had entered the back and had exited out the front.
And there was no gunshot residue on the front of the blouse, which would have been present had she committed suicide.
They did not find any evidence of that in the front or the back of the blouse. And that indicated that the weapon was at least some 30 inches to 3 feet away, according to their findings.
Frias denied he murdered his wife and pointed to the fact that his right arm was broken and he wasn't able to maneuver the rifle himself. Nevertheless, Ernestine's death was ruled a homicide. Based on the forensic evidence, prosecutors believe that Frias and Ernestine fought when she arrived home. A violent tug from the rear ripped her pants, causing the bruises on her abdomen. As Ernestine was getting up from the floor, prosecutors say Frias shot her in the back. Blood spurted out of her stomach and struck the wall in front of her. As she fell to the floor, her body twisted in reaction to the shot, and she landed on her back. Prosecutors say Frias left the rifle on the ground to make it appear that death was a suicide. They didn't believe Frias' cast would have hindered his ability to fire the weapon.
I feel like the whole world fell on top of me. It was just like a real nightmare. I was just like, gosh, why me? What do I mean? I couldn't. I was shocked. I was shocked completely.
Martin Frias was charged with his wife's murder. Since he couldn't afford an attorney, the court appointed one for him. At the time, the state public defender's office used the state crime lab, the very same lab used by the prosecution. They had already ruled Ernestine's death was a homicide. Frias' attorney tried to come up with an alternative explanation for Ernestine's death, but he couldn't.
We felt bad about how the trial was going to go. I remember a public defender investigator named Walt Carroll and I talking before the trial started about what a grim prospect it looked like for Martin.
And they were right. The jury convicted Frias of second-degree murder and sentenced him to 25 to 35 years in prison. But the story doesn't end there. After the murder conviction of Martin Frias, his attorney, Robert Moxley, started gathering information to file an appeal. Meanwhile, Moxley started to have misgivings about the competency of the state's pathologist who had performed the autopsy.
The pathologist in this case was not qualified to do forensic cases. And that's probably being charitable.
So he asked Dr. Robert Lance, an independent gunshot residue expert, to test Ernestine's blouse.
I've used a much more sophisticated, much more modern technology called scanning electron microscopy with X-ray emission. And what this does is it provides much better sensitivity for gunshot residue. What this told me was the gunshot residue had come from the front very clearly and had followed the bullet right on through her abdomen and come out the back.
This contradicted tests done by the state crime lab, which found no evidence of gunshot residue anywhere on the blouse.
The tests that had been done by the crime lab were some rather archaic chemical tests, where it's possible to do them just a little bit wrong and not find any gunshot residue.
Suddenly, Frias' story that Ernestine had committed suicide didn't seem so far-fetched. Yet, Frias remained behind bars.
My life in prison, it was miserable. I was mad, angry. It was something that I don't wish nobody go to prison for something he didn't done.
After 2 years in prison, Wyoming's Supreme Court granted Frias a new trial. But the defense had their work cut out for them. Prosecutors ordered Ernestine's body exhumed for a second autopsy. The chief medical examiner for Houston, Texas, Dr. Charles Petty, performed this one. The results of the second autopsy were the same as the first. The bullet entered Ernestine's back and came out through her stomach.
I think that the evidence
showed at that time, and still does in my mind today, that Martin Frias shot and murdered Ernestine Perea.
But the defense introduced some new evidence in the second trial, that Ernestine was suicidal and that slash marks on her wrists proved she had tried to kill herself numerous times before.
I was able to document between the different stories and the medical records somewhere between 5 and maybe a dozen prior suicide attempts or suicide gestures.
And Moxley attacked the heart of the prosecution's case. The first point was Frias' contention that he didn't hear the gunshot from the living room. Acoustics expert Dr. Harry Holleen provided an explanation. Holleen conducted a test using the body of a dead horse covered with a fabric similar to Ernestine's blouse with a 300 Magnum rifle, similar to Frias' rifle. The first shot, 3 feet away from the horse, was very loud.
When the gun was fired in the open, we got dB readings of somewhere between 110 and 120 dB, and it sounded like gunfire.
But when the muzzle was placed against the skin and material, it sounded very different.
The gunshot doesn't sound like gunfire. It sounds like someone kicking the side of a building or kicking a piece of furniture, and the energy level is quite low.
The sound was similar to what Frias described on the night of his wife's death. Judy Bunker, a blood spatter expert, analyzed the blood evidence on the wall, only 18 inches from the floor. She says it clearly shows Ernestine was sitting on the floor with the rifle to her stomach when the shot was fired.
The bullet fragments in the wall, their location, along with the blood spatter location across the wall, and given the location of her wounds, would indicate that she was either kneeling or seated when the shot was fired.
And she found no blood spatter evidence to suggest, as prosecutors contended, that Ernestine was shot in the back, then twisted in the air while falling to the floor.
I learned from Judith Bunker that if somebody gets shot and spins around, that, you know, they spew vital fluids around.
But there was no blood spatter on the floor, walls, or the bed from the twisting motion the prosecution says occurred. The defense theory. But prosecution experts said there was a problem with that theory.
Had this weapon been used in contact with the body at the time of discharge, that I would have expected that there would have been blood and or tissue on the muzzle of the weapon, and there was none.
Dr. Vincent DeMaio, an expert in high-velocity gunshot wounds, testified for the defense.
The absence of blood on the weapon means absolutely nothing. Maybe half the times with handguns, you don't find blood on the muzzle. It's a little more common in shotguns, we'll say. But don't forget, with rifles, and in this situation, you had clothing in between.
Dr. DeMaio also believes that the autopsy photos clearly show that Ernestine was shot in the stomach.
When you discharge a gun, out the muzzle of the gun comes a flame. That's about 14 to 1500 degrees. And out comes gas, and out comes soot, carbon from burning gunpowder. If you put the muzzle of the gun against the body, then you're going to have the soot and the flame burns, and then the effects of gas. If you look at the wound in the abdomen, there's soot and there's flame burns. That means the muzzle was in contact with the body the time of discharge. Therefore, this has to be the entrance.
And Dr. DeMaio says the gas discharge from the rifle temporarily inflated Ernestine's abdomen with enough force that it ripped her jeans, contrary to the prosecution's claim that they were torn during a fight. Lastly, prosecution experts testified, as they did in the first trial, that they found no gunshot residue on the blouse, supporting their claim that Ernestine was at least 3 feet away when the gun was fired. The defense presented their new scanning electron microscope evidence of gunpowder residue on the blouse. And with that, the defense rested their case. In a moment, the verdict. In Martin Frias's second murder trial, there were two very different theories presented to the jury. The prosecution theory was that Martin Frias shot Ernestine in the back as she was getting up from the floor after a fight. After the shot, Ernestine twisted as she fell to the floor, which explains why she was found on her back. The defense maintained that Ernestine was sitting on the floor. The rifle was upside down. She used one hand to hold the muzzle against her stomach and the other to push the trigger. During deliberations, the jury wanted to see if a woman Ernestine's size could accomplish what the defense said happened.
And there was a small woman on the second jury. They took the gun into the jury room and she sat down on the floor and replicated my theory. And she told me later that her finger had touched that scope on that rifle exactly where Ernestine's fingerprint had been. Same alignment.
After 2.5 hours, the jury had a verdict. Not guilty.
I don't question the wisdom of the jury. I can see where they may not have been sure who had the accurate opinion, who had the accurate theory. And there's no question in the criminal justice system, as it should be, that if there's a tie or even anything close to a tie, that, it's beyond a reasonable doubt. And I think the jury didn't acquit Martin Frias because they felt he was innocent. But I believe that they acquitted him because they could not find that he was guilty beyond any reasonable doubt.
I was so happy that I kind of feel like crying at the same time.
We hugged each other and danced around the courtroom a little bit. It was a good moment.
Martin Frias now lives in Southern California. He is now an American citizen and has tried to get custody of his children, but they remain with Ernestine's mother in Wyoming.
I'm married, I got a good job. I can't complain, I make good money. Got a little girl. We enjoy life.
The forensic experts who assisted Robert Moxley in the second trial did so without remuneration.
The forensic community rallied around me in this case to make sure that I got the help I needed, to find the expertise I needed, and there are just all kinds of people out there committed to making sure that justice got done in this case.
American justice, it does work. It's better than our time.
We'll be right back. Madeline Murray O'Hare was America's best-known atheist, principally responsible for abolishing prayer in public schools.
Madeline, you either liked her or you hated her.
In 1995, Madeline Murray O'Hare mysteriously disappeared from her Texas home, along with her son John Murray and granddaughter Robin. Over $600,000 of their organization's money disappeared along with them.
What is it not to love about this story? It involves greed, it involves gold, it involves the most hated woman in America. This is a sexy story, and we should tell it.
It was a local newspaper reporter playing forensic detective who helped solve the case. Madeline Murray O'Hare was often called the most hated woman in America.
Mr. Withers, is this a form of harassment?
No, ma'am.
If it is, I will leave.
I am creating the record.
No, you're not creating the record. You are wasting my time.
These are...
When you're done reading that, call me. I'll be in the ladies' room.
Is it your understanding then that you have brought
call
no documents
me
today?
In the ladies' room when you're done.
She was an avowed atheist who achieved fame in 1963 by opposing prayer in public schools. She took her case all the way to the United States Supreme Court and won. She founded the nonprofit group, the American Atheists, as well as a magazine preaching the gospel of strict separation of church and state. She also wrote articles for Larry Flynt's Hustler magazine and was the subject of a Playboy magazine interview. Madeline O'Hare was a difficult woman to work with and was notorious for speaking her mind.
All right then, don't f*** with me.
I have never encountered a more bitter, more distasteful person than Madeline Murray O'Hare.
Don't touch me.
She was extremely foul-mouthed to the point that even though we were doing an interview about something that she wanted us to do a story on, we had to stop the interview in the middle because she was cursing so much.
You have a limited opportunity this morning to ask me questions. Why don't you get to the question?
In August of 1995, 77-year-old Madeline, her 40-year-old son John, and 30-year-old granddaughter Robin left Austin, Texas without saying a word to anyone. The staff of the American Atheist Organization found a note on their office door saying the O'Hares had been called away for an emergency and didn't know when they would return. John's Mercedes-Benz and Robin's Porsche were gone too. But they left their passports behind, as well as Madeline's diabetes medicine and her three dogs.
Madeline may not have cared very much for people, but she sure loved those dogs, we were told.
Couldn't get in touch with them, and I got concerned, so I started making phone calls. And then I called John's cell phone, and that's when Madeline answered.
But Madeline wouldn't tell board member Ellen Johnson where she was. Johnson said the calls were short and strained, and she worried that Madeline and her son were under some sort of duress.
You know, I questioned him about what was going on, and you know, he tried to reassure me that everything was okay, and I believed it.
Just 1 month later, Madeline and John stopped answering their cell phone calls. When Ellen Johnson took over the American Atheist Group in Madeline's absence, she discovered that since the O'Hares disappeared, more than $600,000 was missing from the organization's bank account.
Suddenly, you have three people and a very large amount of money all disappearing at the same time, and this makes it far more interesting.
John McCormick covered the disappearance for the Express News in San Antonio, Texas.
Among the atheists, there was a very peculiar silence, but beneath it was a very profound concern. They were very concerned. They didn't know what to do. They hadn't really attempted to get any help from law enforcement.
No one associated with the American Atheists reported the three missing, And it wasn't until a year later that Bill Murray, Madeline's estranged son, filed a missing persons report with Austin police. Madeline and Bill had a rocky relationship. In 1980, on Mother's Day, Bill told Madeline that he had embraced Christianity and was no longer an atheist. He then went public, writing a book and making a film attacking his mother's beliefs.
My mother loved confrontations, and she never hesitated to use me as an accomplice in her schemes. She wanted to push the school prayer issue as far as she could, so she instructed me to keep a record of prayer and Bible reading at school. It was here in my home my mother made me a spy for the cause of atheism.
Madeline immediately disowned him, and Bill never again spoke with his mother, his brother John, or his daughter Robin. Bill didn't know if his family's disappearance was foul play or if they had stolen the atheist's money and fled. A year after Madeline Murray O'Hare disappeared with her son John Murray and granddaughter Robin, journalist John McCormick learned what the American atheist group already knew, that John Murray had withdrawn over $600,000 from the atheist bank account just weeks after the three disappeared. McCormick also examined John's cell phone records, which indicated he had been living in San Antonio, Texas, after his disappearance. Many of the 200 calls were suspicious.
They've been calling financial institutions, they've been calling airlines, they've been calling drugstores to get Madeline's prescriptions. There were more than 150 calls. They called jewelry stores.
One of those jewelry stores was on Frederickson Road in San Antonio. The owner said that John Murray purchased $600,000 worth of gold coins using cash. Even after Madeline's son, Bill Murray, reported the three missing, the Austin police showed little interest.
There was no investigation by the Austin Police Department. It was a total joke.
The police reaction may have been based on their belief that Madeline and her family absconded with the atheist money and that it was an internal matter.
How can somebody that's that famous turn up missing with all that money and still no one wants to look for her? So I decided I'd be part of the team that went looking.
Television news reporter Valerie Williams discovered that John Murray sold his Mercedes-Benz for $15,000, well below the car's value, to this man, Mark Sparrow.
John Murray.
The seller identified himself as John Murray.
Sure, no problem.
Low miles.
Yeah, it's 20,000, is that about right?
Yeah.
But when shown a picture of John Murray, Sparrow said it wasn't the man who sold him the car.
He said his name was John Murray, and that's not the guy who sold me the car.
Would you mind taking a look at these mugshots for me?
After reviewing mugshot pictures, Mr. Sparrow identified the impersonator as another missing person, an ex-convict named Danny Fry. This was an interesting coincidence. Danny Fry's family told police that Danny had been working with another ex-convict, David Waters, who had once worked for Madeline O'Hare and had a falling out. In 1993, Madeline hired David Waters as her office manager. Within a few months, she fired him, maintaining he had stolen $50,000 from the atheist organization. Waters was charged with theft. He accepted a plea agreement and paid the money back, and in so doing, avoided jail time. But Madeline was furious that authorities allowed Waters to go free. Using the power of the pen, Madeline wrote an article in her magazine exposing Waters as a thief and implied Waters had homosexual relationships while serving an earlier prison sentence for assault. When Waters saw the article, friends say he vowed revenge. Journalist John McCormick called Waters and asked him if he had anything to do with Madeline's disappearance.
You're not, you've got anything at all to do with this.
I didn't believe a word he said, but he spoke as though, it was the truth.
McCormick discovered that David Waters, Danny Fry, and another ex-convict, Gary Carr, were all working together in Austin, Texas, around the time the O'Hares disappeared in August of 1995. And not long afterwards, a headless, handless male torso was discovered in a Dallas river.
They'd spent 3 years trying to figure out who it was, but they had no fingerprints, no dental, and they had no missing persons records that matched this disappearance, so they were totally stumped.
McCormick had a hunch that this body was somehow connected to the O'Hare's disappearance. Not long after the O'Hare's disappeared, a male torso was found in a Dallas river. Without a head or hands, fingerprints and dental records couldn't be used for identification. Forensic anthropologists estimated the man to be between the ages of 35 and 45. He had a stocky build and a lot of chest hair. The description didn't fit Madeline's son, John. But journalist John McCormick had a hunch. He told police that it might be Danny Fry, the man who had impersonated John Murray when selling his car. Scientists took DNA from Danny Fry's brother and compared it to the blood DNA of the torso. It was a match. Just as McCormick suspected, the dead man in the river was Danny Fry.
The blockbuster was when we could write a story that said that the headless corpse in Dallas was Danny Fry, and by the way, he was last seen with David Waters in Austin, and by the way, he spent his last month in San Antonio at the same time the O'Hares did, so that really kicked in the door.
Suddenly, local, state, and federal law enforcement officials took notice and joined the investigation. When David Waters' ex-girlfriend, Patty Steffen, read about Danny Fry's murder in the newspaper, she immediately called the FBI.
At first, she wanted to tell us small bits and pieces. You have to understand, this was a woman who was terrified.
She gave investigators an important lead. 3 years earlier, she said that David Waters had rented a storage unit around the time the O'Hares disappeared, and that Waters had once gone there with this spray canister. Laboratory tests on the canister revealed it had once contained bleach, which is sometimes used to remove blood evidence. Armed with a search warrant, police found a tiny red stain beneath a piece of aluminum under the wall. It was so small, it was almost invisible. With blood from Madeline's son Bill for comparison, a mitochondrial DNA test revealed the stain was a mixture of two people, Madeline Murray O'Hare and her son John Murray. Next, the FBI searched Waters' apartment.
We found documents that belonged to the O'Hares that were dated after David Waters had been fired from their organization.
Mr. Waters, himself a prior convicted felon who was not allowed to have guns or ammunition, was found to be in illegal possession of about 118 rounds of handgun ammunition of three different calibers.
They even found books from the O'Hare library and a bow saw. The FBI confronted David Waters with the forensic and physical evidence against him. It took quite a while, but eventually, 5.5 years after the O'Hares disappeared, Waters led investigators to a remote burial site at Camp Wood, Texas. Forensic anthropologist Dr. David Glassman was there.
When we hit the first bone, it was kind of interesting in this case because the bone was very large. And it was the upper leg bone. The upper leg bone is the largest bone in our skeleton, but this one was particularly large.
After 21 hours of excavation, Three adult bodies were uncovered. In each case, the legs had been cut off, possibly to make it easier to transport the bodies.
And one of the bodies, the hair was very well intact, a female skull, and the hair was braided down the back of the neck of the individual. There were some remnants of clothes that were found, but no clothes that were intact.
There had been some effort to burn the remains, not to the point of cremation, but in order to destroy maybe the clothing or any other DNA evidence that might be there.
As the remains were unearthed, shining in the afternoon sun was the metal plate of an artificial hip. Medical records revealed that Madeline O'Hare had undergone hip replacement surgery several years before her disappearance. The serial number of the hip in Madeline's medical file matched the number on the hip in the grave. Forensic odontologists compared the O'Hare's dental records to the skulls in the grave and confirmed that these were the remains of Madeline, her son John, and granddaughter Robin.
For John Murray, when he was in the grave and uncovered, he did have a plastic bag over his skull. And when the plastic bag was removed, there were small fractures that occurred to the skull itself, indicating some blunt trauma had been done to him during the time of his death.
The cause of death for Madeline and Robin couldn't be determined by looking at the bones. But since their heads were covered in plastic, it was assumed they were asphyxiated. But investigators found something else: an extra head and two extra hands. The head showed a single gunshot wound at the base of the skull. Forensic scientists used a photo superimposition technique for identification. They suspected the skull was that of Danny Fry, the man whose torso was found in the Dallas River. Scientists took a photograph of Danny Fry, then photographed the skull at the same angle and size. The two photographs were superimposed to see if the facial features matched the skull.
For example, the distance between the eyes and the shape of the nose, and the distance between the nose to the teeth, and the distance across the cheeks. And every area that I examined in the video superimposition matched up.
The motive for the O'Hares' murder had been revenge. But why had Danny Fry been murdered? The forensic evidence found years after the O'Hares' disappearance tied David Waters and his two associates, Danny Fry and Gary Carr, to their murders. David Waters' girlfriend, Patty Steffens, told police that Waters kidnapped the O'Hares because of the unflattering and inflammatory article Madeline had written about him.
His girlfriend said he fantasized about torturing her, cutting off her toes. And so basically, I think this whole thing came down to not just money, but really ugly personal chemistry between two dysfunctional personalities.
For David Waters, it was about revenge. He wanted the ultimate revenge on Madeline O'Hare, and the money was just a byproduct.
After kidnapping the O'Hares, Waters forced John Murray to withdraw $600,000 from the atheist bank account, and then took him to the jewelry store to exchange the $600,000 for gold coins. The O'Hares were most likely dead by the time Danny Fry impersonated John Murray to sell his car. But why was Danny Fry killed too? The answer was his drinking.
We knew that Danny Fry drank, and loose lips sink ships. And by what David had told Bob Fry about his brother, and that was, you know, your brother has a big mouth, could be the thing that caused his death.
But David Waters made several crucial mistakes. Although Waters cleaned the room with water and bleach, scientists still found a tiny speck of blood 3 years later. identified by mitochondrial DNA as that of John Murray and Madeline O'Hare. But removing Danny Fry's head and hands still didn't prevent identification. DNA and skull photo superimposition were all scientists needed. Ironically, after stealing the $600,000 from the O'Hares, Waters never got the opportunity to enjoy the money. It was stolen from him.
Well, his first mistake was putting his money in a storage locker up in Austin and having three bozos from San Antonio who were looking for used TVs open up the locker with a master key and find a suitcase with $500,000 in gold.
For his role in this case, David Waters was sentenced to 80 years in prison. His accomplice, Gary Carr, was sentenced to life in prison.
Mr. Carr fully admitted his role in involvement with David Waters in the abduction, robbery, and murder of the O'Hares. And he indicated that he had assisted in dismembering the bodies and putting the body parts in 55-gallon drums in a storage unit here in Austin.
It was a nice, neat ending. They found the bodies, the bad guy goes to prison, and, you know, the hero's right off into the sunset.
For his persistence, John McCormick is one of the heroes of this case. And forensic science played an important role, too.
Well, I mean, this was definitely one that, if it wasn't for DNA, we'd probably still be scratching our heads as to who this person was.
A lot of times I kind of forget about the case when the next case comes in. And so I really don't have one that always jumps to mind. But I'll remember this one for a long time.
Eyewitnesses said they saw a man in a pickup truck deliberately run over another man, not once, but twice. Police could not find the victim's body or the pickup truck. And when police tried to talk to the two eyewitnesses, they had disappeared too. All police could find were some blood stains in the snow. But would this be enough to prove murder? On January 29th, 2001, a member of a motorcycle gang in Duluth, Minnesota, called police to report his roommate, 27-year-old Eric Schrieffer, missing. He said he hadn't seen Schrieffer for the last 4 days, and he was worried.
Usually that doesn't happen. People that report missing persons usually call in within the first 6 to 8 hours in a panic.
Well, great. I appreciate your assistance. Have a good day.
Officer Ryan Temple was assigned to the case.
Hi, this is Officer Temple.
I attempted to contact all the area hospitals, all the county jails in the area, the Duluth Detoxification Center. Also tried to contact the victim's family, his mother, his father, also his employer.
No one had heard from Eric Schrieffer. He worked as an apprentice for the Boilermakers Union 647.
Eric was very quiet and reserved. Very good performance on the job site.
But he hadn't been to work either. Police found Schrieffer's three automobiles still in his driveway. His wallet and winter coat were inside his house. police discovered that Schrieffer was last seen at a party in a motorcycle clubhouse. Two motorcycle club members who were at that party, Charlie Johnson and Herbert Zingel, said that Schrieffer got into an altercation with Joseph Weymanen, a member of a rival motorcycle club. The two were separated and escorted outside. Where the fight resumed. Her was still on the ground. Weymanen did the unthinkable. He got into his truck, started the engine, and intentionally ran over Schrieffer. Amazingly, he wasn't killed. Weymanen then put his truck in reverse and ran over him a second time. Fearing for their own safety, the witnesses ran back inside. When they looked out again, both the truck and Schrieffer were gone.
There was something more to this story than just a missing person.
The witnesses admitted they were drinking heavily that night and weren't sure of all the details. And the alleged fight took place almost a week earlier, and the inclement weather complicated the investigation.
There was a 4-day time lapse, and we had received approximately 8 inches of slushy snow in between time. It made it a very difficult crime scene. Once we got there, there wasn't a whole lot to see to start with.
When police looked into Joseph Weymanen's background, they discovered he had never been in trouble with the law. He was an ex-Marine who had served during the Gulf War and was a member of the Thunderbird motorcycle gang, although not an active member. Investigators needed to find some forensic evidence to corroborate the witness's story. Police wanted to find some way to verify the claims of two eyewitnesses that Eric Schrieffer was run over twice by Joseph Weymanen in his truck.
From the very beginning, we had to try and put the case together to understand exactly what had happened, and then attempt to try and locate where possibly the body had gone to after that period of time. So initially, we were trying to put the puzzle together before we could find out where the body may have gone to.
Police set up a command post in the alley where the fight allegedly took place. Working in sub-zero temperatures, officers uncovered the top layer of new snow in order to search for blood. They were successful. They discovered a blood trail that led from the alley all the way to the end of a parking area nearly 80 yards away. At the end of the trail, police found one very large pool of blood in the snow.
Due to the amount of blood that we found in that one spot and the fact that there was no blood after that, as we continued to excavate the snow past that point, we believe the body was loaded into the truck.
Medical examiner Dr. Donald Kundal was called to the scene.
A person to produce that much blood in one localized area had to still have their heart beating. They may have suffered serious injuries, but their heart had to still be beating in order to produce that much blood coming from a wound.
Once the heart stops beating, a body no longer bleeds. The blood evidence suggested that the victim was lodged under the truck and was dragged 80 yards. The pool of blood at the end of the trail indicated the victim was still alive and had been picked up from the snow. However, Dr. Kundal told police that without immediate medical attention, the victim would have died within 4 hours. To collect the blood evidence, police used a standard coffee filter to separate the blood from the snow. The filter trapped the red and white blood cells and allowed plasma and melting snow to drip through. Just as the filter traps coffee grounds, not allowing them to drip into the coffee. Without a body, police had another problem. How to tell whether this was the blood of Eric Schrieffer? But police got a break. They learned that Schrieffer had undergone hand surgery a few years earlier when he had accidentally shot himself. The hospital saved Schrieffer's tissue sample that had been sent to the pathology lab for analysis. The tissue was preserved in paraffin, which halts the degenerative process, preserving the tissue indefinitely. The blood DNA found in the snow was compared to the DNA from Schrieffer's tissue sample. It matched. Police canvassed area hospitals, health clinics, and doctors' offices. No one with the type of injury Schrieffer would have sustained had been treated. Convinced that Eric Schrieffer could not have survived without treatment, the medical examiner signed a death certificate.
Yes, we do have a homicide, and one of the worst types for a detective to have, a homicide without a body.
The next step was for police to speak with the driver of the truck, Joseph Wayman, but he was uncooperative.
He started to shut the door on me. At that point, I reached over and grabbed him by the shirt, informed him that he was under arrest for murder.
Police impounded Wayman's vehicle. But a forensic analysis found no evidence of an accident. They found no trace of blood, body fluids, or hair anywhere on the truck or underneath.
The crime lab is well respected by law enforcement agencies in this state. They've got the best equipment, the most sophisticated gear. And if they couldn't find any evidence in the truck, then you started wondering, well, how could that be? How could somebody drive a truck over somebody twice and there's no hair, no blood, nothing? And that didn't seem right to me.
The lack of forensic evidence wasn't the only problem. Witnesses' credibility was another. During police questioning, both witnesses admitted they were inebriated at the time of the alleged accident. One said, quote, "I don't remember who was at the house, who came back. We were sitting there drinking. I know there was people in and out. Like I say, I'm drunk. I stay drunk as I can." And Joseph Wayman maintained his innocence. With two inebriated eyewitnesses, no forensic evidence in Wayman's truck, and no body to prove there had been a murder, prosecutors knew they didn't have enough evidence to go to trial. Investigators needed more evidence in the Eric Schrieffer case, and the search for his body intensified. Police decided to find out how their prime suspect, Joseph Wayman, spent his leisure time and with whom.
I came across one of his friends and asked, when's the last time he'd spent time with Wayman? Where was that he spent the time with him? And it came to be that within the week previous, he was ice fishing with this friend.
Police had a general description of the ice house that Wayman and his friend used, but they weren't sure where it was located on the vast St. Louis River. Nevertheless, police were assigned to search the area.
He came across an ice house, weren't quite sure whether it was the one that we were necessarily looking for, but as he was looking into the ice house, he found a hole that was larger than your normal ice fishing hole, probably the size of one that a human could be slipped into.
An underwater dive team searched the frigid waters of the St. Louis River for Schrieffer's body. Conditions were miserable. It was snowing with wind gusts up to 30 miles per hour. Divers could stay under the freezing water for only 30 to 45 minutes before suffering hypothermia. After days of searching, they found nothing. Then investigators got more bad news. Their case against Wamanin was based almost entirely on the testimony of two eyewitnesses who claimed they saw a fight between Schrieffer and Wamanin. But when police went to question them further, the two had vanished.
We have actually documented testimony from family members of the two witnesses that the Thunderbirds were approached by the Hells Angels and in turn approached the two witnesses and asked them to leave the community. Downright threatened them.
With no body, no forensic evidence against Wamanin, and now no witnesses, the defense filed a motion to dismiss the case. The prosecution was in a difficult position.
All the while, too, we are looking for the body, and we're looking for some more physical evidence to tie Joel Wamanin into this. We were convinced that he was the person responsible for the death, but he wasn't saying anything.
The more police thought about Wamanin's truck and the eyewitness testimony, the more they realized how unlikely it was that the undercarriage of his truck would be so clean, especially in the middle of winter. In the words of investigators, it was almost too clean. So nearly 6 months after the murder, they examined the truck once again.
We decided we would take the truck apart piece by piece until we were satisfied that there was no evidence to be found or we actually found evidence. And that's what we did.
We had a belief all along that if the truck was used in transport of the body, there always has to be some type of forensic evidence that's left behind. Or in any kind of crime scene, I strongly believe that there's always forensic evidence that's left behind in any crime scene.
They hoisted Wamanin's truck up on a rack in the police garage, and bolt by bolt, they took the truck apart.
I think I used the analogy in one of my stories. It was like they were cutting their lawn with tweezers. They went over that vehicle inch by inch.
For over 2 days, police searched every inch of the vehicle. Finally, they found their first piece of evidence, a single strand of human hair that was attached to the front spring of the truck. And when they removed the top covering of the truck's cargo area, they found several small blood stains in the crevices. Police now suspected that Wamanin power sprayed his truck after the murder, and the water pushed the victim's blood into the tiny crevices between the sheets of metal. But scientists still needed to find out who the blood and hair belonged to. When police found bloodstains and a strand of hair in the undercarriage of Joseph Wamanin's truck, they promptly informed Wamanin's attorney that they would be sending the materials for forensic testing.
Once the state could tie the body to Mr. Wamanin's truck, the case changed dramatically. And I talked to Joe and I told him so. Ultimately, it comes down to the old Kenny Rogers song. You gotta know when to hold them and know when to fold them. And I felt it was, when they found that blood in the truck, it was time to fold them.
Without even waiting for the results of the forensic testing, Wamanin agreed to lead police to Schrieffer's body in return for a reduced charge of unintentional second-degree murder. The prosecution agreed, and Wamanin confessed.
It's my opinion that this forensic evidence was so powerful that Mr. Wamanin knew what the outcome would be when we sent it to the lab and just decided to plead guilty.
In Wamanin's taped confession, his version differed from the eyewitnesses.
I was panicking, I was in a state of shock. I knew all of this was gonna come out eventually. I was going to be going to prison. I was angry with him.
Waymanen admitted running over Schrieffer in the alley, but said it was an accident. He also said he didn't realize Schrieffer was stuck under the truck until he reached the end of the parking lot. Waymanen said he put Schrieffer in the back of his truck and dumped him into the river the next day. He said the police had searched the correct spot in the St. Louis River, but the body may have drifted. When the divers returned for a second search, they still couldn't find the body. A few weeks later, after the plea agreement was signed, Schrieffer's body surfaced by itself on the Wisconsin side of the river. The autopsy revealed that the cause of death was blunt force trauma to the head. In Waymanen's mother's garage, police found a cinder block. Its size and shape were consistent with Schrieffer's head injury. Waymanen didn't deny striking Schrieffer in the head with the block, but said he did it after Schrieffer was already dead. Prosecutors were skeptical.
He says he hit him with a block when he was wrapping up his body at his mother's garage and hit him with a block of cement just out of frustration, expressing an anger at Eric Schrieffer for having caused him to do this. Doesn't make a lot of sense.
Because of the plea agreement, Joseph Waymanen was sentenced to 12 and a half years in prison for Eric Schrieffer's death. He'll be eligible for parole after 8 years.
12 years in prison for a murder where you drive your vehicle over a body one time, then back over it again, if the witnesses are to be believed, to me, that's not justice.
The family wanted us to make some type of negotiation, compromise on the amount of time, and in return for recovery of the body. And I remember even telling Eric's mom and dad and brother that Joe Waymanen is not going to get what he deserves for what he did to Eric. I made that very clear to them, and that's what I even told the court at sentencing. But we were willing to make a compromise in order to recover the body and put the case behind.
The other reason for the deal was the disappearance of the two eyewitnesses. They are still missing to this day.
I hope they are okay. I hope nothing has happened to them. And if we can find out who is responsible for their disappearance, for their being conveniently absent at a time when we needed them, for us having to reduce the charge from murder in the second degree intentional murder down to unintentional, we want to know. Then there'll be a little bit of finality to this case.
The case was solved by forensic evidence Waymanen couldn't power wash away. Waymanen knew that the blood found in the metal crevices and the single strand of hair were Schrieffer's, and that forensic testing would prove it.
I strongly believe that there's always forensic evidence that's left behind in any crime scene. It's just a matter of your human eye picking up and looking in certain places and using the current technologies to locate that forensic evidence.
Forensic science was remarkable because without the police department going that extra distance and finding that evidence in the truck, in the tailgate, in the undercarriage, without the medical examiner finding that blood sample with the matching DNA at the end of that alley, we would have been out of luck.